It's Fran at my bench, and today I'm going to do a little video about something that curiously people don't really talk about, and that is the mysterious black smudges that you get in vacuum tubes, like this beautiful 300B, silvery or black. What the hell is that, and why is it in my tube? The mysterious material in vacuum tubes that you find is called the getter, and it's appropriately named because its purpose is to get gases out of the tube. It's really the reason that high vacuum production tubes were made possible, and it's really the reason that tubes stay high vacuum after they've been sealed. It's all about the getter. So let's take a closer look and I'll explain. Whew. Okay, so I've got an assortment of tubes on my bench here. I was showing this 300B for one of the tubes from my hi-fi, and it's got a beautiful double getter. Come on. Oh yeah, look at that. There's one, two getter rings. Yep. This is actually a good example because these are really large, and you can see, see if I can get a little closer, you can see the detail in there. You can see the sort of the melted sort of a look of the back of that ring. This is how the getter works. The purpose of the getter is to, like I said, to absorb gases, and in most tubes like this, it's barium that's deposited. It starts out as like a powdered or crystalline form of barium azide, which is basically a barium atom and six nitrogen atoms. So it's a volatile compound. Most azides are explosive because it contains so much nitrogen. But barium azide, it's chemically stable at room temperature in atmosphere. So it's put into a little ring like that, right? And when the tube is being evacuated and it's hooked up to a high vacuum pump, after it gets down to a certain level of a relatively high vacuum, the getter is heated with an induction, usually put in like a high RF field that causes induction heating, and that getter is heated up, and when it reaches a certain temperature, the barium azide breaks up into barium and nitrogen, and the nitrogen gas gets sucked out from the vacuum pump, and the barium gets deposited as an elemental barium on the inside of the glass. And because barium is such a highly reactive metal, it will act to attract and react with any gas that either gets into the tube or is residual, because after a tube is made, there are residual gases in the materials that get released during the heating of the cathodes and the plates and such. Tubes do get warm when they operate, and so it's a natural part of the tube that it will outgas a certain amount, just the materials will outgas as the tube is used, and the getter picks that up in addition to any gases that are left in the tube for manufacturing. Because the other advantage of the getter, as I said earlier, that the getter made high volume production of vacuum tubes possible, because to get a legitimately high vacuum in a tube, even using a diffusion pump or a turbo molecular pump, it really takes hours to get the a really suitable high vacuum for a tube like this, and having the getter in there shortens the time from hours to minutes, because with the getter, especially like this is a double getter tube, so you know, with a high volume in here, after the tube is evacuated to a reasonably high vacuum, it can be sealed off after the getter is activated, because sealing off the tube, the getter will take up the rest of the free air molecules that are still left in the tube over time. And so you don't have to have it attached to a diffusion pump, you know, trying to get those last few, you know, try to get as rarefied as possible. After a certain point, it gets very, very hard to evacuate a tube because when pressures get so low, you don't have the molecules banging up against one another, and they get far enough apart that they're really just not pushing against each other anymore. And the temperatures are getting so low in the tube because of the, you know, the diffusion of the gas that really the getter makes it economical. And also the getter, I mean, it's often said that the getter is a chemical vacuum pump, which it really is, because it works for the life of the tube. Some tubes like this one, this is an OC3 or a 0C3 for you purists. But this is a neon-filled voltage regulator tube. This is also out of my amplifier. I've got two of them in there. They regulate to 105 volts DC, and I've got two stacked for a 210 regulated supply for my indicator tubes in the hi-fi that I designed. But these OC3s, people are going to say, it's not OC3, it's 0C3. Okay, yeah, fine. So, but these tubes, they have a lot of getter. Lots and lots and lots of getter. Because, again, a regulator tube like this, it really, really, really has to have no intrusion of oxygen or nitrogen or any other kind of gas, because in order for it to really regulate, it's depending on the ionization of gases that are in it at a very specific pressure, and so any intrusive gases in there is going to throw off the regulation. So lots and lots and lots of getter. And some people, like, see there's a dark band in the middle here. These tubes have run a lot, so that dark band in there is where the getter's, it's reacted slightly, just because, again, you know, I've run there's a lot of hours on these tubes. But that doesn't mean that there's anything wrong with the tube. Lots of times you get a getter, like this is one of my 6HU6s, CRT display tubes that the double OC3 power supply regulates for these tubes. So this is much more black than silver. That's not an indication of a bad tube or a bad getter. That's just an artifact of the manufacturing process. Because as I've learned, if the tube is evacuated very slowly and the getter's heated slowly, you'll end up with a beautiful silvered mirrored-like surface that can even be like slightly transparent, like mirrored sunglasses. Sometimes you can actually see through it slightly. But if it's evacuated faster, that being that if the getter is heated and activated before the tube is really properly evacuated, the getter reacts with the remaining gas in the tube, and then it deposits a rather dark kind of silvery face. It can even be like black, like onyx black. But that's just an artifact of the speed at which the tube was produced, more than anything else. Here's another example. Vacuum fluorescent tubes have getters, because vacuum fluorescent tubes are very high vacuum tubes, and in order for them to operate properly, you can't have any intrusive gases in there. This is a very miniature one, but they all work exactly the same. You can see the two cathode wires in the front there, and then you see a little mesh. It's a type of grid, but it's in vacuum fluorescent tubes, the grid is positively biased. It draws electrons from the cathode that go through the mesh, which is positively charged relative to the cathode, and then they smack into the anodes, which actually have the phosphor on them. But this one, you can see the getter on the top here, and a tiny little getter ring in there, a little cup there, and that's pretty typical. Sometimes other vacuum fluorescent displays, like this one, pretty beautiful, huh? This was actually sent in by someone for a viewer mail, but it's a matrix type vacuum fluorescent display. These things are used for like you know, equalization, having like a graphic EQ, stuff like that. But even in these sort of flat ones, they do have getters, and you can see them in the corners here. They put them off to the side where they won't be obtrusive. This one's got two of them. You can see one, two, off on the side there. And, yeah. So just one example. Another example for a display tube is Panaplex. And so these Panaplex displays are kind of unique. My Heathkit clock, which I restored, is running really good. I've got some extras for these Panaplex displays. Oh, it's all dusty. It's dusty, but it looks great. It's Panaplex displays, and this is a neon-filled tube, even though it doesn't look like a tube, but it is. Very unusual, because the cathodes are in the back there. Those metallic-shaped segments are the cathodes. The anode is actually this glass face. The inside, or the inside coating of that glass, has a conductive coating, which you can sort of see there, the opening. That's the anode. These metallic contacts here, these little springy contacts, they actually make physical contact with that coating in the front and take it out to pins in the back. But these have getters too. See this tiny little ring here? I don't know if it's going to show up. But that tiny little ring, you kind of see there, it's got it's scooped out, it's cupped, and the getter is actually inside of that metal ring. It's not flashed like the other tubes, so there's no mirrored finish on the inside of the tube, because again, they couldn't flash a tube like this, because you would end up getting getter into the area where the display would be. But that little ring is filled with a getter that I'm going to show if you look. Okay, all right. See, look, watch the ring. Yeah, see it move? It's just whopping around in there. In fact, they have that ring around the one contact there, flopping around in there, but that little spring contact holds it in place. But that's in place there, right next to the little nipple, right there. Again, that would be close to where it's evacuated, because when you activate the getter, it's gonna, you know, it's gonna be near the evacuation. But they're different types. I'm not exactly sure the technology involved in that, you know, because it's probably not induction heated like others. I'm not sure if it's barium or some other kind. There are other more exotic like materials that they use for getters in certain applications. So maybe someone can comment if you know about the getters they use in a Panaplex display. But another tube that people are very fond of these days is the Nixie tube. Yep. Nixie tube. And Nixie tube, of course, it's a gas-filled tube filled with our favorite of all gases, neon. But Nixie tubes do not have a getter in them. I don't think they have a getter. It could be that Nixie tubes have some kind of infused getter, where it's actually infused into part of the metal or something, but they're not flashed. There's no like silvery coating on the inside of Nixie tubes. So I mean, I might be wrong. I mean, there are people I know on who have YouTube channels where they make Nixie tubes. If they do incorporate a getter, please make a post about how it's done. But I think one of the issues with Nixies is that they do tend to get gassy over time, and they can start to glow purple as nitrogen, you know, gets in into the tube. You got lots of pins, lots of opportunities for there to be, you know, very, very, very microscopic leaks. Nixie tube, it is a low pressure tube, so, you know, but yeah, the Nixie tube, not any visible getter. Let me pull another tube. What the hell is that for, Fran? What's that for? Oh, that's for this. Oh yeah, look at that. Ha ha. Beauty. Yeah, this is an RCA 833A transmitter tube. It's a triode, high power triode, and this tube came out of from a 2000 watt AM radio station. I pulled this back in the 90s on a transmitter I was working with a friend who was doing some maintenance, and there was an array of these tubes all running to get the necessary output power. But tubes like this, really high power tubes, they can have an array of things. This tube here, here we go. It's got a getter in the back, a small one. kind of hard to see through the glass. There it is. A little cup down there and a little bit of getter, a tiny little bit of getter on the tube. But now that little bit of getter, that might have been just for the manufacturing process, because usually these large tubes that run hot, and particularly the ones that have, you know, plates that will glow red or even white, often what they will do, and again, tube experts can chime in, but often they incorporate more exotic types of getters that are actually embedded in the materials or sintered into some of the materials that will activate when the temperature inside the tube gets up to, you know, operational temperatures, you know, up in, you know, 600-800 degrees or more. So, but this tube is actually still good. usually with these tubes, the reason that they would pull these out is in the old days, you know, after they stopped really readily manufacturing tubes like this, they would, you know, they would reclaim a tube like this. You know, they would take out, you know, replace the innards, you know, re-evacuate it, and, you know, swap out the guts and, you know, or a refurbished tube. But this is one example. Let me pull another. There's another example. This is also a little dusty. This is a 4400A. This is another power tube, audio amplifier, or RF tube. This has got a lot of use in it. In fact, you can see the down in there, some scorching and whatnot. Now this is another example of a tube that it doesn't have any getter cups in it, but it obviously has getter in it. And this is one of those types of tubes that has the getter actually in the materials themselves. Exactly how it's done, I couldn't tell you because I'm not a tube expert, but obviously, you know, whether it's embedded in the plate material or whether it's inside of the assembly, you know, so that when it gets up to full temperature, because these run red hot, you know, when they're up to full power, the plates glow red hot, and in a tube like this, the getter will be activated by the heat. I think they call them non-evaporative getters or something, but I'm not exactly sure how it works, but they do employ more exotic reactive metals in some of these, and I think too, while I have my big tubes out, I think people might say, "Oh, Fran, those are radioactive. These tubes are radioactive." I've heard about that. You know, some tubes do have radioisotopes that they use. Certain tricks to the metallurgy of tubes that's very mysterious to me. But they do sometimes incorporate radioisotopes to accomplish certain things in tubes. But I don't think any of those emissions really can be felt outside the tube. I've turned on my garden counter. Oh. I mean, I love my Geiger counter. Everyone knows that. I love my Geiger counter. But I've got it on the lowest possible setting. I'll even open up the alpha beta tube. Yeah, it's nothing above background. I've tried this with all my big tubes. And, you know, take it away. Just get the background, and yeah, there's no emission at all. So, yeah, some tubes, I mean, might be thorated or have some kind of, you know, gamma-producing radioisotopes in there that you might be able to detect outside glass. But at least my tubes, you know, they're just not active. It's just regular background. Very disappointed. It'd be cool. Yeah, let's try the other tubes. My 300B? Nope. Display tubes, OC3? Nope. 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 Nope, none of my tubes are radioactive. Oh well. But any excuse to pull out my Geiger counter. I should make a t-shirt that says, "I heart my Geiger counter." Because I love my Geiger counter. Love my Geiger counter. It's always fun when you find something radioactive too. It's like panning for gold, you know, when you're going around the Geiger counter, you find something that's a little radioactive. It's like, ooh, found something. But not today. Oh well, I tried. that's it for this one. Hope you got something out of it. Like I said, I'm not a chemist. I'm not a glass blower. I don't have any of those mad skills. I don't make tubes. I know some people on the YouTubes have entire channels dedicated to making tubes, and maybe a few of them will comment about this, but it's just a cursory look into the chemical magic of getters. All right, I'm Fran. Thanks for watching, and thanks to everyone on the Patreon. 2021, we survived that other year. So thanks for coming along with me, all the patrons who have hung in there with me through that awful other year. And we're looking at having some fun and learning some new stuff in 2021. Can't believe we all made it. Okay. I'll be back here real soon in the lab. Bye! Work. In the lab. Go berserk. In my lab. It's where I work.
Oh, fuck.